Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Our next speaker is Alan Rosen. He's a faculty member at the Interdisciplinary Center in Herzliya. In the School of Computer Science. Alan got his PhD from Weizmann Institute and was a postdoc at MIT and Harvard. And his interests are in, of course, cryptography, with a focus on theory and applications of cryptographic protocols. And he's also interested in the construction of efficient cryptographic schemes with provable security guarantees. Alan probably saw more of India than most Indians here. So if you have questions about...
Combined.
So if you have questions about, you know, how to survive your sightseeing adventures in India, he's the guy to ask for advice.
Thank you for inviting me. It's always fun to come back. So I will talk on the learning with rounding problem. We'll talk a bit about reductions, mostly about applications, and mostly about the one application of this problem. It's been introduced a couple of years back, and my personal belief and hope is that it will have more applications. So I think it's a good enough reason to talk about it. And I'd like to thank Chris for some of the slides. I could have not pulled these slides off on my own. It requires very high programming skills to draw things like this. So let's talk about a motivating example, which will be will occur throughout the talk. It's pseudorandom functions. It's a concept that I assume most of you are familiar with, but let's just repeat the definition. So we're talking about a family, a kid family of functions that takes k bit strings into some group D of elements, such that any adversary that is given adaptive black box access to the function, meaning that it gives an input to the function, gets the output with this fixed key S, and you can choose the subsequent inputs adaptively based on the previous inputs. You cannot distinguish whether he was given black box access to the actual function or to a random function, which has a huge description, of course, and could not be described explicitly. And we call this S, the index of the function S, we call it the seed or the secret key of the function. And this is sort of the fundamental object of symmetric key cryptography. It has applications, very simple constructions of symmetric key encryption, authentication, identification follow from this abstraction. And it's really very useful and very powerful. And given that it's a symmetric key kind of primitive, of course, we would like to build fast implementations of such objects. So we do have extremely fast implementations of pseudorandom functions, pseudorandom permutations in practice, such as AES, Blowfish, and many others. And they're pretty secure in practice. It would be crazy to say that they're not secure. And they withstand the known cryptanalytic techniques, and they're also very fast, implemented in hardware already, built in. Some would say they're faster than the identity transformation. But still, we would like to understand the security of these objects. We know this PRF requirement is very strong. It is true that they already had it in mind when they designed these ciphers, but not being able to distinguish a function from a random function is a super strong requirement. To distinguish, you don't even have to recover the key, right? It's much easier, presumably, at least on the face of things. And our motivation for this work and then for subsequent application was to understand what does it take to get this kind of security. And also, as a side point, the design of these primitives is not super complex, but it's pretty complex. So the lack of cryptanalysis could be in part attributed to this complexity. It's very hard to analyze and to understand which role plays each decision in the design due to the complexity. Then on the other end of the spectrum, we have these theoretical constructions which can be based on any one-way function. Okay, when they introduced pseudorandom functions, Goldreich, Goldwasser, and Micali, they suggested pseudorandom functions based on any pseudorandom generator, which means you can build it on any one-way function. If cryptography is at all possible, you have PRFs. And this is the construction, it's very simple. You have a k-bit input, and the function just breaks the inputs into bits and applies a length doubling generator either and takes either the left side or the right side. The bit decides which side you take, and you do it iteratively k times. You apply it iteratively k times. And this is a pseudorandom function, assuming the pseudorandom generator is secure. The problem with this construction is that it's inherently sequential, because it takes at least k iterations, where k is the input size. And this translates into very high circuit depth if you want the k-bit input function. Other constructions are based on less generic assumptions. They're based on assumptions such as the Schiedler and Diffie-Hellman and the factoring. They are based on an object that is a strengthening of a pseudorandom generator. It's called a pseudorandom synthesizer, which can be thought of, and we'll talk about this object later, can be thought of as a pseudorandom generator that can be computed locally and is secure against even if the adversary observed correlated evaluations of the generators. And using this concept, they managed to build a relatively low depth pseudorandom functions. In NC2, NC1, and even TC0, if you're not based generically on the synthesizer, but you actually use the property of the underlying synthesizers, we will see the constructions today. They're very simple and very nice. The drawback of these approaches, of the ones from the late 90s, is that they require large circuits because they require a modular operation, modulo large primes, or modulo composite numbers, which are very large, in order to be even remotely secure. And another comment that could be said is that the underlying assumptions can be broken by quantum algorithms. Not that I think it's a very important issue, but still it should be mentioned. So the question is whether we can get alternative constructions which are as shallow as an Orr-Rheingold one and that admit a more reasonable circuit size. And the natural candidate for this kind of underlying assumptions and primitive is lattices. So we want to build a lattice-based PRF. Okay, that would be the idea. And the reason we would like to do that is because lattices have these advantages of using very simple and efficient operations. Modulo small numbers, potentially, not modulo large numbers. And the operations are very parallelizable. The linear algebra operations, which can be highly parallelized. There's the issue of quantum attacks that are not known so far on lattices. And also, there's a very important issue that was not mentioned so far today, is that the lattices have worst case to average case reductions, which is pretty remarkable. Meaning that if you can break instances on the average, you could break any instance. And this gives us more confidence in the underlying security of the construction. The problem is that the only construction that we knew until the work I'm going to describe here, that is based on lattices, is the GGM construction, meaning that it builds a pseudorandom generator from a lattice and then applies this inherently sequential transformation. So it's not parallel and nor efficient. And moreover, we don't even have practical pseudorandom generators. From lattices, we'll talk about it soon, on the problem of constructing such things. So what we'll mostly talk about today is on a pseudorandom function that have a really low depth, and they have relatively small circuit size. And we'll show proofs, reductions from the hardness of learning with error and ring learning with error that was mentioned by Nadia before. I'll show two constructions. One is synthesizer-based. We'll show the full construction. And another one is direct. We have a better proof of security, a better reduction of security for the synthesizer-based construction. But at the same time, the direct construction is more efficient. We can instantiate it with constant depth, with threshold gates. And even though we don't have a very good proof of security, we do conjecture, believe that it could be secure. It's just that we don't know yet how to analyze it. And there is enough structure there maybe to come up with a proof on one side or to attack it on the other side. And the main technique, and this is the main idea I'm going to talk about today, the main new idea, is this new problem that is related to learning with errors, which we call learning with rounding. And you can think of it as a de-randomization of the learning with error problem. Okay, so it's just a deterministic way to get the hardness you get from learning with error, and potentially even more, okay, in some cases. And as a byproduct, we also get more practical PRGs, and even if we instantiate it with the GGM construction, we get something interesting, something non-trivial, because the PRGs are so efficient that if you're willing to pay the depth for the input size, you get something with very small key size relative to other constructions, and it's pretty efficient. If you don't care that much about the depth, or if you want a short input pseudorandom function. Okay, so what is a synthesizer? I said at a high level what it is, but let's go more into details. So a synthesizer is a deterministic function that takes two elements in the set D and returns one element, so that for any number of samples, A1 to AM and B1 to BM that are taken from the set, this is a polynomially many samples that will fit into the first input, and these are polynomially many samples that will fit into the second input. If we look at the matrix of all the pairwise evaluation of these samples, meaning the S of AIBJ, it's an M by M matrix, then this matrix is indistinguishable from a random matrix of the same dimensions and drawn from the same domain of element. And this is an assumption, okay? Suppose we had such a primitive. So this is how it looked like pictorially. The rows are indexed by the AIs, by the first part of the input, and the columns are indexed by the second part of the input, and then you just write down all these correlated outputs of the synthesizers, and this should be indistinguishable from random. Another way of viewing it is that this is a pseudorandom generator, okay? That is almost length squaring. It takes d to the 2m and maps it to d to the m squared. And which is very local, okay? Each output depends on only two inputs. So this is another way of thinking of it. So it's a strengthening of a pseudorandom generator, but still presumably not as strong as a strong pseudorandom function. This is a weak PRF. I was just about to say. Thank you very much. So it can be constructed for a weak PRF, and the weak PRF can be shown. It can be shown to imply a weak PRF. It's equivalent. There's not a difference. So yeah, whenever I say synthesizer, and you're Vadim, you could think of a weak PRF if you want. So here's a construction of PRFs. A weak PRF, okay, sorry, a weak PRF, think of a PRF that is required to be secure only against randomly chosen inputs on which the adversary has no control. So the adversary gets to see pairs xi, f of xi, where xi is randomly and independently chosen. He sees the input, but he has no control over it. And presumably, it's easier to construct than a strong PRF. So here's the construction. Suppose of a strong PRF, one that is adaptively secure from a weak PRF or from a synthesizer. So suppose you have this synthesizer, and we do an inductive construction, a recursive construction. The base case is very easy. You can get it unconditionally. Here's a PRF that takes one bit of input, okay, and is secure unconditionally. The key consists of two random strings, which are kept secret. This is the key of the PRF, and the bit X chooses which one of the two to output. This is great. What will we use the synthesizer for? We'll use the synthesizer for inductively increasing the input length. Okay, so now we want to double the input length, and suppose we have a k-bit PRF family. It's a secure PRF family that we have constructed. It's secure again with the k-bit inputs. You take a k-bit input and returns an element in domain, and now we're going to construct a 2k-bit input function. Where the key or the seed of the function consists of keys for two functions, left function and right function, which we inductively constructed. And the value on an input XLXR, we parse the input into two halves, is just the synthesizer applied to the pseudorandom function on the left part concatenated with a pseudorandom function on the right part. And assuming the synthesizer is secure, this is a secure pseudorandom function. So you can see visually what this corresponds to. At the leaf of this binary tree, you have these pairs of strings. This is the one bit PRF that you have. And then at each level of the tree, you pair up adjacent nodes and apply the synthesizer recursively. And the depth of these things is logarithmic in the input size. So here you see the saving in the depth of the function. And the idea for the security is simple. Since these are inductively proved to be secure PRFs, then the inputs are pseudo-random. You can replace them with random. And once these inputs are random and independent, you know that the output is pseudo-random. That's the whole idea. One thing I want to mention as a side remark is that this construction really requires the full security of a synthesizer the way we defined it for polynomially unbounded many queries, like M. If you remember, you have A1 to AM and B1 to BM. For the proof to go through, you'll need M not to be bounded in advance by any polynomial, because the adversary can get adaptive access to the function in polynomially many points of his choice. It will come up later. Yes?
You also have a much larger key size than the median.
Yes, true. And this is what I mentioned before, that if you don't care about sequentiality, but you want a short key size, then GGM might be better for you. And it is very true. The key size here is very large. It's quadratic, assuming that the input size is large. Are there more questions so far? Good. Okay, so now let's jump to the learning with errors problems from which we would like to construct these synthesizers. We would hope that we can construct. So this was defined by Regev in 2005. The security parameter is the dimension n, and we have a modulus q that is greater than or equal to 2. And let's define it as a search problem for a second. So the idea is that you can push a button, the adversary can push a button and get random linear equations that are noisy. Linear equations of S. And his objective is to solve for S given the noisy equations. And the way these equations are defined, you get a label. The first sample is label A1, it's chosen as a vector and dimensional vector modulo Q. And then what you get as a sample is a number modulo Q, which consists of the inner product of the secret with this public label A. This is known to the adversary, plus a small error relative to Q. And then you get as many samples as you want. The error, usually the distribution of the error, is Gaussian center around zero, if you think of Q as going from minus Q, ZQ of going from minus Q minus 1 over 2 to Q minus 1 over 2, then you think of the error as centers around the origin, the zero. And what we want, we have this Gaussian with the parameter alpha, the standard deviation parameter alpha, that satisfies that alpha times Q is at least square root of n, where n is the dimension. This is what we usually instantiate it with. There's also a decision version. So the search version is the challenge of the adversary is to retrieve S. If there was no error, then it would have been trivial because it's solving linear equations. The idea here is that solving noisy linear equation is hard. That's the whole idea underlying, the whole intuition underlying LWE. And the decision version, which says it requires the adversary to distinguish between these pairs, these labels and these noisy samples, and uniform pairs. The label is anyway uniform, so only the BI part, only the sample should be pseudo-random, indistinguishable from random. You could also view it as multiplying this label matrix, A1 to AM, a capital A with the secret, and then adding a vector of errors, m errors. So this is a generalization of an older problem introduced in the early 90s and originating from learning theory, which is called learning parity with noise, in which we talk about an equivalent, analogous learning problem, modulo 2, and where the noise model is just Bernoulli noise. You flip the bit with some probability or do not flip it with some probability. And why, intuitively, why do we need the error alpha q to be at least square root of n? So one reason it's required is that because we do have a worst case to average proofs for LWE. We know how to reduce worst case lattice problems to the problem of solving LWE. But these reductions, they require alpha q to be at least the square root of n. That's one reason. But even more importantly, if you're going to instantiate it, then and you want security, practical security, then there's actually the best attack runs in time exponential in alpha q squared. So if you want security 2 to the n, you should choose alpha q to be at least a square root of n. This is an attack by error again that exploits the small error, if the error is small. So LWE satisfies some simple properties, which we'll go over very quickly. So one thing is relatively easy to see is that if you get a solution, a candidate solution for LW, you can verify that it's indeed the solution, provided that you have sufficiently many samples, which is not a problem because the adversary can get as many samples as you want, let's say polynomially many samples. For now, you just multiply your candidate solution by the public labels, take the difference from the samples, and see if the difference is small in all coordinates. This will not be satisfied by non-solution, and will be satisfied by solution with high probability. It will be satisfied always, but with a non-solution with high probability. Another property is that if I'm given a sequence of samples of LWE, I can shift the key, secret key by any value that I want, particular random value. So I'm given the label A and the sample B, S times A plus E, I just add to B T inner product with A, and it will produce a sample where the secret is S plus T. This is just linearity. And if we choose random T's, this works for any T, if we choose random T's, then we get a random self-reducibility. So if it's somewhat hard, it's very hard. Okay. So if we have non-negligible probability of success on a uniform S, we can actually have overwhelming probability of success. Another property which will be useful for us, which is very simple, is that you can reuse the labels. You can reuse the A's with multiple secrets. This is a simple hybrid argument. So this distribution that consists of a public label A and samples B1 to BT, where each one of them is generated by corresponding secret, different secret, this is indistinguishable from random. You can apply a hybrid argument where each successive hybrid is indistinguishable from the previous by the basic LWE assumption. And this follows from the fact that the labels, the AIs, are public, are known to the adversary. Another property which is nice is a search to decision equivalence. If you remember, I first stated it as a search version and then I stated it as a decision version where you cannot distinguish the samples from a random collection of samples. And it's also a very simple idea. Let's assume, just for simplicity of presentation, that Q, the modulus Q, is polynomial in N. I didn't say it, but Q can be taken very small, can be of constant size, up to exponential, and so on. This affects mostly the efficiency, also the security, but mostly the efficiency. And let's assume for a moment that we're at the regime where Q is polynomial in N. So here's what you do to solve the search problem given an algorithm that solves the decision problem. Suppose you have a perfect distinguisher. We might as well assume it because of the self-reducibility that we just talked about. We have an almost perfect distinguisher. How do we use him to find the solution? So it's sufficient to test whether S1 equals 0 or any candidate number between 0 and Q minus 1. And we could do them one by one because Q is polynomial. And here is the test. So for each sample AB, I choose a fresh random value R. And then I evoke the distinguisher D that works perfectly on pairs of the proform A prime, A comma B, where A prime is just A minus R and all zeros. And the result of this is a new sample of the form S inner product with A prime plus S1 times R plus the error, again, due to the linearity. So it just focuses on the first coordinate of S and either shifts it or not, depending on whether S1 is 0 or not. And we have this property that is, if S1 is 0, then this part is 0, so then you get an LWE sample. And the distinguisher will tell us LWE. It's so good that you can do that. And if S1 is not 0 and Q is prime, then we get a uniform. So the distinguisher will tell us uniform. And we can do it coordinate by coordinate to get the entire sequence. So this is a very nice property that you would always like to have. And by now we know that you don't really need the Q to be polynomial nor prime. And there are sophisticated techniques to get rid of these assumptions. That do some work and get rid of these assumptions. Okay, so now I introduced the LWE. We talked about some nice simple properties. And remember, our motivation is to use LWE to construct a synthesizer. So here's the LWE assumption, written just for the sake of consistency and completeness. It's hard to distinguish pairs AI, BI plus error, where BI equals AI times S plus EI and error BI. And again, because of the hybrid argument that I said before, we might as well look at labels of the form AI, where AI are matrices, are just bunches of samples, batched samples together. And we can reuse these AIs with the different secrets. This is a matrix of secrets S1 up to K matrices of secrets. So we have samples of the form AI, comma AI times S1 plus EI1, which is a modulo Q, an n by n matrix modulo Q. And we have polynomially many of these. And this is as hard as LWE. Follows from what we said before. So here's an idea for an LWE-based synthesizer. It's a very natural idea. So the rows, the inputs to the synthesizer will be the AIs and the SJs. Okay, these will be the two inputs. And the rows will consist of the AIs. The column will correspond to the SJs. And the value at the ij location is AI times SJ plus an error that corresponds to that location, EIJ. By the LWE assumption, this is uniform. Okay, so this whole matrix is indistinguishable from random, so it does satisfy the security requirements for a synthesizer. However, there's a problem with this. It doesn't work, and why doesn't it work? Why isn't this enough for a synthesizer?
That is the error.
Yes, exactly. So the catch here is that this EIJ, we need many of them in order for the function to be evaluated on unboundedly polynomially many points. And we do need the description of the function, the seed, to be independent, sort of independent from the number of values that the adversary gets. We need a bounded description of the function. So this will not work. It's a very nice candidate, is as secure as LWU, but doesn't work as a synthesizer because it's not a deterministic function. It's a randomized function. And here enters the new idea. It's a very simple idea, super simple idea, and it gets around this problem. And the idea is instead of adding random errors each time, we'll have a deterministic way of generating the errors without having to sample these EIJs. And the idea is that instead of adding this EI or EIJ, we just take A in a product with S and we round it. What does it mean round? At the most basic level, it's just throwing away many of the bits, like the least significant bits of the value modulo Q. And this is a technique that is very prevalent in other applications, but I think this is the first time it was used in this context. So we have a value in ZQ. This will correspond to the B, to the A in a product with S, without the error. And it's a value modulo Q, and now we round it to a value modulo P, where P is smaller than Q. Okay? Can think of Q being a large power of 2 and P being 2. Okay, so you go from 2 to the L bit, values modulo 2 the L, like L bits, to values modulo 2. Or in this example, you could see that Q equals 24. You have all values modulo 24, and you round it in modulo 3. Okay, any value that falls in this interval is rounded to 0, any value that falls into this interval is rounded to 1, and any value that is falls into this interval is rounded to 2. Okay, so this is formally, this is a function. We have p that is smaller of q than q, and we define the rounding of x modulo p, where x, remember, it's a modulo q, to be the rounding, the nearest integer to p over q times x, all of this mod p. This is formally the function, and this is what you get. But for special cases, it's even nicer to describe. Like I said, if q is a power of 2 and p is 2, then the rounding just takes the most significant bit of the value. That's what it is. And the nice thing also is that if p divides q and you apply to a random value, mod q, you get a random value mod p. Okay? If zp is a subgroup of zq, this is what you get. So this is formally the LWR problem, learning with rounding problem. You want to distinguish any polynomial number of pairs ai, rounded ai in a product with s mod p from uniform, and the difference from LWE in what you get is that you get a pair where the first element is mod q, whereas the second one is uniform mod p or lies in zp. So you get less bits. Less bits for the money. And an intuitive way to think of why this is secure is to think about it in the following way. What does LWE do? What's the role of the error in LWE? You add a small value, so what does it correspond to? It corresponds to adding noise to the least significant bits, to hiding them. And we assume that this makes the problem already very hard. All that LWR says, let's throw them away. Instead of hiding them, let's just discard them. Cannot make the problem any easier. Maybe even harder in some cases. So we have a theorem that there is a reduction from LWE to LWR, meaning that if you can solve LWR, you can solve LWE. So it's as secure as LWE. This theorem works as long as the ratio between Q and P is super polynomial. At least this is the proof we know of. But for all we know, one could tighten these parameters and make the ratio Q over P as small as the square root of N. And actually, this is a very important problem, because if you're going to ever instantiate it with concrete parameters, you're going to have to understand how secure this thing is, exactly as the function of Q over P. And for efficiency, you really want Q to be small. If you really want to implement this thing. So, and it's still open. And what's the idea of the proof? I'll just go quickly over the idea. So we have two points that are important here for this rounding function, and the same theorem will apply for other rounding functions that satisfy the same properties. Let's start with the second property. The second property says that if you apply the rounding to a uniform value, modulo q, you get a uniform value modulo p. Or in other words, the rounding function is balanced. Okay, so that's one requirement. And the second requirement is that if you take a sample and add small noise to it and round, you will get with high probability the same value of the rounding without the noise. Or in other words, the rounding function is noise insensitive. So you take any noise insensitive balanced rounding function, the theorem will apply. And the idea is that this is the LWE problem, right? Without the rounding, like you have A and A inner product with S plus E, and the rounding operation is efficient, so you can apply it to the LWE sample. And since there is noise insensitivity, then this is with high probability identical to the value without the noise. So you get that if you start from here, this is identically distributed to this, or statistically close to this distribution. And then, from the LWE assumption, it follows that this and this are indistinguishable, right? AS plus E is indistinguishable from random. So now we could replace this for random, and what we get is that this is indistinguishable from this, and this is what we wanted. So this is the whole idea. But here, really, I want to emphasize that we really use the noise insensitivity in a very strong way. Since we get polynomially many samples, we want that for all samples this hold. Okay? For the proof to hold, we need for all polynomially many samples, this equality has to hold, or at least you need statistical closeness between these two distributions. And it's not clear yet how to get it with a random function that works for small q's, or for q and p that the ratio is not super polynomial. Okay, so this is the bottleneck that we have right now in the proof. But it's not clear that it's impossible to bypass it, and I think it's a very interesting and important problem in this context. So let me skip the properties of LWR. They're very similar to those of LWE. It's random self-reducible, and there's the search-to-decision reduction. The reduction are slightly different than what I showed you. Okay, they're as simple, but it's slightly different. You shift labels, not secret, and so on, but they're quite similar. And let's jump directly to the synthesizers. Yes, Sunny.
So the reduction you have, they assume for any device, LWR is hard for small q, for example, those two work?
You're asking if the reduction still works when LWR is hard? Yes. Yeah.
That's still okay?
I think so. I'm not 100% convinced, but I suspect they have nothing to do with LWE. They don't go through LWE if that's what you're asking.
Okay. There's
never this. No. They're very simple. They're like straightforward.
Okay.
There's nothing like convoluted. Okay. So here's the synthesizer, the simplest synthesizer ever. So the inputs to the synthesizer are two matrices, n-dimensional matrices, modulo Q. And the synthesizer is just the product of the two matrices rounded, modulo P. Okay, so you multiply the matrices modulo Q, and then you round modulo P. What do I mean by rounding a matrix? Entry-wise. Okay, I take each entry. Each entry is a number modulo Q, and I entry-wise round modulo P. For now, if you look carefully, you see that the range Zp is slightly smaller than the domain Zq, depending on the ratio between Z and Q. And what this means is that if we are going to compose this thing many times, as we will do if we go on to PRF, then we have a limit on the number of times we can compose it. But in the next slide, I'll show you a way to get rid of this assumption. So this is a secure synthesizer assuming LWR is hard, which is secure assuming LW is hard and Q over P is super polynomial.
How much is smaller than P?
How much? What?
How much it is smaller than P is bigger than Q?
So all we need for the reduction, if that's your question, is that the Q over P is super polynomial in N.
So but you are doing modulo P, and P is smaller than Q.
Yes.
So what range of that is smaller
than Q? You're asking by how much P is smaller than Q? It could be, depends on the concrete security that you want, but it could be anything smaller. You need Q over P to be super polynomial, asymptotically. Yes?
It's following up on Levinsky's method. That's if you want to base it on LW. But if you were to propose LWR as
an independent assumption.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What would you like?
Square root of N. The ratio, you're asking about Q over P?
Yeah.
Yeah, I would take square root of N and risk my life and reputation.
So it seems like a rather the problem why you need it is artificial because of the spillover at the edges, right? Maybe there's a difference in going to LWE, but have you thought about like reducing it to the underlying hardness problem directly, and maybe that problem doesn't arise when you do that?
We have tried, we haven't succeeded yet, but it's possible. But it's a good direction. It might be that the difficulty is an artifact of going through LWE.
Yeah.
Yes, definitely. Okay, more questions while we are here? Okay, so here is the PRF that we get by just applying the synthesizer-based construction of Naur and Rheingold. So what we have this tower of public moduli. D is the depth of the tree. It's log of the input size. And we have for each level in the tree, we have a different modulus. We start with the first level has the largest modulus, then we will be rounding to a smaller one, and so on. So it's a sequence of moduli. The secret key is 2k square matrices. We call them SIB, where I is between 1 and k, and b is 0, 1. And these matrices are chosen over ZQV, the first modulus. And then the PRF, let's say on 8 bits of input, it defines explicitly the following way. It's just a binary tree of depth log k where you apply the rounding-based synthesizer iteratively. So you take the innermost pairs of matrices, multiply them, then round modulo Q2. You start at modulo Q3. This is Q3. It's log of 8. You round them in modulo Q2. You do this for every pair of adjacent matrices. Then you get the result modulo Q2, multiply it, modulo Q, round it modulo Q3, and so on until you get to the root. And this is the PRF you get. So it's a pretty simple PRF. It's matrix multiplication, rounding, matrix multiplication, rounding, and so on.
How does it compare to the generic technique in terms of efficiency?
The DGM?
Yes.
So,
if you take the lattice-based one-way functions and then just apply generic transformations and make a PRF,
I think I've never tried to look how this compares. I have a different construction that I'll show later. But even this one, I think, would be much more efficient than the generic one. Just suspicion. I don't know. I just suspect. Yes, but on the other hand, the LWE could give you a PRG because the decision version is sort of hard. So it's all a question, a matter of how many bits you need for the noise. It boils down to this, in order to get a length doubling generator. But I haven't calculated. But I suspect it's more efficient. Okay, so we had this tower of moduli, QD up to Q0. Let's see how to get rid of it, because it's a very nice idea, by Krzysztof Pieczak. He said, you know what, you might as well do the following thing. Instead of taking square matrices, n by n, let's take rectangular matrices. This doesn't make the problem any easier. So instead of taking n by n, we take m by n. And now we'll get more bits per matrix multiplication, because now we can stretch the rectangular matrices and get the higher dimensional matrices from the multiplication. So you take an m by n matrix, multiply by an n by n matrix, you get an m by n matrix, and by choosing m larger than n, you get more bits. And the synthesizer is the same, it's just the dimensions are different. And if you take m to be, let's say, 2n, this of course generalizes, but if you take m to be 2n, and take q to be p squared, so the number of bits in p is half the number of bits in q, then you preserve the total number of bits in the input and in the output. Okay? And now you don't shrink anymore, at least in terms of quantity of bits. So here is the construction. You take a public modulus q, which is going to be invariant across the evaluation of the function at all levels, q equals p squared. The secret key is rectangular matrices instead of square matrices. And now, given an m by n, a two n by n matrices, you take the product rounded modulo p, now you get a square matrix with the 2n by two dimensions 2n by 2n. And since Q has twice as many bits as P, you can cast this exactly into a 2n by n matrix modulo Q. Just somehow route the bits in one matrix entry into the other, and you get the same dimension again. So you again, the output of the synthesizer has the same size as the input for the synthesizer. It's a 2n by n matrix modulo Q. So this is very cute. It's a method not to having to use a...
So why stop at this rectangular matrix? You could get many more bits by taking a vector, multiplied with a vector.
Yes, but this would be at the expense of the ratio between Q and P. Yeah. And it could generalize to L times N times N, and P, a Q equals P to DL. It's the same idea. It could generalize. This is a special case. And this is the synthesizer you get, and the nice thing is that the modulus Q is preserved in all levels. Okay. Notice that the evaluation of these functions requires many matrix multiplications and a large key size. And as has been mentioned before, there is this variant of LWE called ring LWE, where you actually have a sort of correlated labels that enables you to represent n samples in a very compact way. By like a n by n matrix can be represented by an n-dimensional vector. And it requires a different underlying assumption that is more algebraic in nature. It's called the ring learning with error assumption. And the idea is to work in a ring that of polynomials with the integer coefficients modulo x to the n plus 1, as Nadia mentioned before. And the operations are modulo q. And the assumption is that it's hard to distinguish pairs that consist of AI, which is now, instead of a matrix, is a ring element of much smaller dimensions, and a sample in the ring. So these are pairs in the ring from uniform. And again, the error EI is taken to be short under some appropriate measure of shortness in the ring. And the nice thing about the ring learning with errors is that the keys are smaller. You don't need to store matrices, you just store vectors. And moreover, the operation of multiplication of two elements now corresponds to FFT, or number theoretic transform. It makes things much faster, even concretely, at the expense of making a potentially stronger assumption. But again, the synthesizer is the same. If you think of matrices in the previous synthesizer or PRF as ring elements, everything is analogous. It's just the operations are faster and keys are more compact. Okay, so far I described you something whose depth is logarithmic. And at each node you evaluate a synthesizer which by itself has logarithmic depth. So it's NC2 construction. And the question is whether we can do even shallower, or can we go to constant depth? And here what we do, we make another leap and we propose a direct construction, which is analogous to the original Naur-Rheingold construction that is based on DDH. That construction, for those of you who know it, in that construction, G is a generator, let's say modulo some large prime P, and the secret key is K elements chosen at random in that field. And the function is just G to the subset product of the Si. So it's a product of the Si, Xi. So whether Xi is 0 or 1 determines whether Si is in the product or not, and they showed that this is as hard as the decisional Diffie-Hellman, and they also showed that with pre-processing on the key, you could evaluate this in TC0, in constant depth with threshold gates. This is what we call the direct construction. So here is an analogous construction based on the LWR problem, or LWE-based. So we'll have public moduli Q greater than P, similarly to before. The secret key is one uniform A in the ring, which could be public actually, so it doesn't have to be secret, and then short secret keys, short in the same sense as the error, K secret keys in the ring. And the function is analogous, it's completely analogous to what we have above. So F of x1 to xk, it's A times the subset product mod Q, rounded modulo P. So this is the proposed function. This function can be evaluated in TC0. With some work. Whether it's secure or not, well, I don't know. We do have a reduction when Q is very, very large. Okay? By the way, here, I want to mention something nice about implementation. To compute this subset product, it's enough to look at Chinese remainder representation in this ring. And instead of computing subset products, you compute subset sums, and then do one exponentiations. And if Q is very small, you can really implement it fast using lookup tables and such tricks. This is a really fast function. It's a side comment, but we implemented this function, and it was really, really fast, surprisingly fast. So what's the idea of the proof? Let me give you just a couple of words about the idea. So again, the seed is a uniform A, and short elements S1 to SK. And this is a function, A times S1 to the X1, all the way to SK to the XK. And the idea is similar to the reduction, the simpler reduction we saw before, but now we need to handle the fact that the adversary gets its adaptive access to the subset products, right? He can choose subset products of his choice and see the roundings of these subset products. And the way we prove it, we make this thought experiment iteratively. In each iteration, we replace one of the elements of the secret key by an LWE sample. Instead of a random string, we pick an LWE sample of the form S1 to the X1 plus X1 to the EX1. X1 is a bit, determines whether we take an error or not. If you expand this, you get the subset product, the original function, plus X1 times EX1 times this product of elements. And the idea is that we took these elements to be short enough so this thing overall is a small error. And then the noise insensitivity of the rounding function will make this whole thing be equal to this rounded thing without the error. That's the idea underlying. So it's very similar. On the other hand, we're abusing very much the smallness of the ASIs because their size grows exponentially with k. Okay, we multiply k of these elements and the size grows up very quickly. So in particular, we will need a very large q for this proof to work at all. And one big interesting question is whether there's an alternative proof that doesn't that scales up much nicely, much nicer with k. When I had mentioned the implementation in the previous slide, we of course pick q to be very small, so the proof doesn't apply at all in this instantiation. It's clear. I mean, it's totally clear that the proof is totally irrelevant. But doesn't mean that there's no other proof out there. And then the idea is to iteratively replace this with uniform, and the proof is analogous. Okay, so we're getting close to the conclusion. So I think the main open question in this context is, besides finding new applications for LWR, because it's very nice in that it doesn't have a randomized error, which is a pain whenever you use LWE, is to find better worst case to hardness reductions for LWR for smaller Q over P. Q over P that is square root of N, and be it by reduction from LWE or directly from the underlying problems, that would be very nice. There is some progress that has been done in this direction. There's a paper from this last crypto that shows that LWR is as hard as LWE, provided that the number of samples is bounded in advance. It can be any polynomial, but it is bounded in advance, and in particular, we can choose the modulus Q to be larger than some factors times this polynomial. This by itself doesn't improve anything in the constructions that we showed. Okay, so the adversary in the two PRFs that we constructed, he gets unboundedly many samples, both in the synthesizer and in the direct construction. So the implication for the security of the PRF is non-existent. But it's still some progress in this direction. And of course, it would be very interesting to find the non-trivial algorithms for LWR. Chi Wang Chao from Chinese University of Hong Kong has shown in his master thesis reduction from LWR to LWE. It's the reverse direction than what we showed. So if you can solve LWE and Q over P is polynomial, then you can solve LWR with some loss in parameters. And the idea is similar to ideas from learning theory that show that learning parity with noise is sort of complete for learning functions that have heavy Fourier coefficients. So it's a generalization to modulo Q of this idea. And there is also an adaptation of Aurora Gate, the attack, the most devastating attack that I mentioned before, at least when the noise is small, and of other attacks to LWR, other attacks on LPN to LWR. But still, there might be more non-trivial algorithms out there. Some other open questions, slightly higher level, is to improve the approximation factors, either by improving the underlying LWR reduction or by proving directly. The synthesizer requires the ratio between Q and P to be super polynomial, whereas the direct construction requires it to be exponential in K, which is much worse, of course, in terms of efficiency. And the question is whether these assumptions are really necessary. If you look at the direct construction, just a second, if you look at the direct construction, there is a chance that this is even harder than LWE, if only because in LWE you get to see the labels of the samples. Okay, in LWE you get to see AI and BI. And here you only get to see the BIs, so you sort of add noise also to the AIs. I don't know if this makes the problem more difficult, but it might make the problem more difficult, so there is hope here to get better things regardless of the hardness of LWE. On the other hand, while we are at it, the samples that you get are correlated. Okay, they're pairwise independent, but not beyond that. So there, you know, it goes both ways. And finally, it would be nice to find the efficient construction from assumptions like LPN, learning parity with noise, when the underlying modulus is 2. Right? All these reductions, they required Q over P to be large, but when you start modulo 2, it's not clear what to do. You would presumably have to aggregate many samples and round them somehow. But then we know from Boolean function analysis that the least noise-sensitive function is the dictator function, which means that you might as well output a single sample. There's no point in rounding if you're going for noise insensitivity. So the same path of proof will not work for LPM. You will need something else, and I think it's a very interesting question. And maybe extend it to subset sum. There's a nice work by Vadim and Gil Segev and Adriana that shows public key encryption directly for subset sum, which is a very hard problem, the average case problem with subset sum. Do you have efficient PRFs from that problem? That could be a very interesting open problem on its own. That's it. I'm ready for more questions if they exist.
Can you go to the previous slide? So the reduction from LWR to LWE, is it significantly more trivial than just putting a random value at the end?
You see it's significantly less trivial, maybe.
I mean, non-trivial. It's significantly more non-trivial than
not significantly more, but slightly more complex.
So it's what's the main technical challenge?
I don't remember. But it's not as trivial as that.
Okay. So that's, I assumed that, but I wanted to know what's the technical
We can check later. More questions? Okay.